Tonight on NewsWatch, the search for Flight 370. More on the missing Malaysian plane and the two men who used stolen passports to make the flight. Plus, Christians in Ukraine, how they are seeking God during this time of turmoil. And see how nature is making a mockery of global warming. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. And good evening, I'm Heather Sells. The mystery behind the disappearance of that Malaysia Airlines flight is deepening. Authorities have revealed that the plane turned around and flew hundreds of miles back towards land before it seemingly vanished. Dale Hurd has more in tonight's top story.
The Malaysian military says it has radar evidence showing the missing Boeing 777 jetliner was heading northeast toward China when it changed course and made it back to the Malacca Strait, hundreds of miles away from the last location reported by authorities. The Malaysian newspaper Berita Harian reports Air Force radar detected the airliner near Pulau Perak at the northern approach to the Malacca Strait. A high-ranking military official said the aircraft was believed to be flying low. Today, authorities appeared to rule out one theory, saying two men traveling on stolen passports were likely not terrorists. They identified both imposters as Iranians, one posing as an Italian, the other as an Austrian. His mother told police he was seeking asylum in Germany.
The interest seems to be dying down because they might just be people who are being smuggled.
The scramble for new leads has now intensified. Police say they're looking at the possibility of hijacking, sabotage, or psychological problems with the passengers or crew. Investigators haven't ruled out catastrophic mechanical failure or an accident. But after 4 days, still no sign of a plane or any wreckage.
It's probably one of the largest search and rescue operations.
If it crashed over the ocean, special ships and submarines need to be within 5 to 10 miles to hear the pinging noise from the airliner's black boxes. Finding them and the wreckage will be crucial to figuring out what happened.
Nothing causes an airplane to come down from 35,000 feet other than things that can be catastrophic.
If the plane did crash, the clock is ticking. The batteries on the plane's black box only last for 30 days. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
The family of one of the passengers on the plane says their faith is helping them survive this ordeal. 50-year-old Philip Wood was an IBM executive in Malaysia and one of three Americans on the flight. His mother told a reporter that God is giving her a peace that passes understanding.
If you want to know how it feels to lose a son at the age of 50, it's devastating. But I know in my heart that Philip's with God, and I plan to be there with him because I have a deep faith in my God.
Wood leaves behind two sons. In other news tonight, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is once again warning against the threat of nuclear weapons from Iran. Netanyahu made that statement as Israel displayed the Iranian weapons shipment that commandos captured last week. Chris Mitchell has the story from the Israeli naval base at the Red Sea port in Eilat.
The weapons included 40 long-range missiles, nearly 200 mortars, and 400,000 rounds of ammunition. Iran hid the missiles inside shipping containers and surrounded them with cement made in Iran.
If these missiles made it to the Gaza Strip, they represented a major threat to Israel's home front. It would have put 5 million Israelis, more than 60% of the population, within range.
It would have made a huge difference if these rockets would have made it into the terrorists' hands. We did a good thing here.
The M302 missiles have a range of more than 120 miles or 200 kilometers.
When you go to 200 kilometers, it's almost not important anymore. It reaches all the important targets in Israel.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu inspected the weapons and said the shipment reveals the true face of Iran and criticized Western diplomats who reach out to Iran's leaders but ignore Iran's actions.
We even saw representatives of the world powers shaking hands and smiling with the heads of the Iran's regime. At the same time, we were unloading these missiles here in Eilat.
He also warned the West they're a future target of Iran.
Does anyone truly believe that Iran has given up its plans to develop nuclear weapons or long-range ballistic missiles that are capable of carrying nuclear warheads to Europe and the United States.
He warned one day Iran could hide a nuclear device in a container and ship it to any port in the world, and said the West ignores Iran's nuclear program at its own peril.
So my message today is simple. Those engaged in self-deception must awaken from their slumber. We cannot allow Iran to have the capability to produce nuclear weapons. Today, Israel thwarted the danger to its people. Tomorrow, if Iran's military nuclear program is not stopped, the whole world could be imperiled.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, the Israeli port of Eilat on the Red Sea.
And for more on this, we turn now to our terrorism analyst, Eric Stackelbeck. Eric, it's interesting because we hear about these threats from Iran, but to see the weapons is another thing. But my question for you is, if Israel hadn't intercepted this shipment, what could have happened?
Well, look, Heather, at least 40 of these missiles were long range. It could reach deep into Israel. So what may have happened is those missiles would get in the hands of Hamas or perhaps Palestinian Islamic Jihad, another Iranian-sponsored terror group there in the Gaza Strip. And those missiles would have been launched at population centers in Israel. That's what likely would have happened, Heather. Maybe not right away, but eventually, maybe in the next conflict between Israel and Hamas in Gaza, those missiles would have been used. And Heather, if you look at the last conflict, November 2012, Hamas, in that conflict, Operation Cast Lead, it was called by the Israelis, were able to almost reach Jerusalem, almost reach Tel Aviv. And these new Iranian long-range missiles that the Israelis intercepted may have been a game changer.
So Israel really has these two threats, Iran and Hamas. Is one of them more significant at this point in time?
Well, absolutely, Heather. Iran, look, is on the precipice of acquiring a nuclear weapon, which it will use, which it has vowed to wipe Israel off the map. So Iran obviously is the head of the snake, the puppet master, and the main threat. But Hamas, Hezbollah, Palestinian Islamic Jihad, these are Iranian proxies where Iran is sending them weapons, sending them money, training them in the finer arts of terror against Israel. So all threats, but the head of the snake, undoubtedly Iran.
Eric, where do you see all this heading? Israel says it will protect itself against Iran by any means necessary. What does that mean?
Well, I think Israel is prepared, Heather, and I think they will probably have to use military action against that Iranian nuclear weapons program. If you look at history, you see that Israel took out the Iraqi nuclear reactor under Saddam Hussein in 1981, the Syrian reactor in 2007. Israel has a precedent here, Heather. They will not allow another country, a Muslim anti-Israel country, in their immediate neighborhood go nuclear, and they will not allow Iran to go nuclear, and that probably means a military solution. I don't see any indication that the Obama administration is willing to go that far with Iran, and I believe that they've pretty much accepted the fact that Iran's going to go nuclear, and they believe they can contain Iran. Israel knows that is not possible.
A lot to watch in the coming days. Eric, thanks for your insights.
Thank you, Heather.
And for more from Eric, make sure you check out his weekly show and his blog, The Watchman. You can find them at our website, cbnnews.com. The European Union is considering tough new sanctions on Russia over its military presence in Ukraine. That comes as the Ukrainian peninsula of Crimea moves towards joining Russia. The Crimean parliament today adopted a declaration of independence. It says that Crimea will become an independent state if its residents vote to split off from Ukraine and join Russia. The referendum vote is set for Sunday. Western nations have said they will not recognize the vote as legitimate. And meanwhile, Christians in Ukraine say their country is at a critical turning point, and they have little time to make sure they get things right. George Thomas brings us the story from Kiev.
Pastor Volodymyr Kunets couldn't be prouder of his country's new leader.
He is a born-again Christian and loves God.
For several years, Oleksandr Turchinov, Ukraine's interim president, has attended Kunets' church in Kiev and serves as deacon.
It is very rare, not just for Ukraine, but the entire region, for a Baptist Christian to run the country.
Turchinov recently told a Christian magazine that God is working in his country, despite the political chaos. He's asking believers worldwide to pray.
I'm so glad he's been given such a position. But from another perspective, it is very scary because we are experiencing very difficult times. We are bankrupt as a nation, and there are many enemies who don't want to see Ukraine do well.
When protests started last November, Ukrainian Christians found themselves playing the role of peacemaker.
How old are you?
Ostap Kirdivik is a leader of the anti-government demonstrators.
During the gunfights, there was a priest who was standing there and who gave his last words and last services to the dying people, and he personally told me that 20 people died in his on his hands.
Men like Father Theodosi Ivashko literally risked their lives to stand in the gap.
It happened just a few feet from here. Hundreds of Ukrainian police stood on one side and anti-government demonstrators on the other, and we took our place in the middle, calling for calm.
Victoria Semenikina traveled to Maidan, ground zero of the mass demonstrations, to pray for families that lost loved ones. She also gives thanks for men like Father Ivashko.
I saw Protestant, Catholic, Orthodox, and other Christians helping those for and against the government. These men and women are also heroes, as much as those who gave their lives for freedom.
For months here on Maidan, the Ukrainian church across denominations played the role of peacemaker. Today, it's preaching a message of reconciliation.
We are preaching this message in almost every service and encouraging people to demonstrate in practical ways how we can help heal our nation.
Parliament member and well-known Christian Alexander Dubovoy says his country has a small window of opportunity to get things right or else.
People are clearly not happy, but we cannot overcome evil with evil. We have to be more forgiving.
Days after the massacre that killed more than 100 and injured some 600 others, Larissa Litvin's church erected this tent for counseling.
So many people have come for prayer. Entire families with children are coming and asking how they can help move our country forward after all the violence and bloodshed. This is a critical moment for us.
One that Litvin and believers here say must be covered in prayer and forgiveness. George Thomas, CBN News, Kyiv, Ukraine.
Coming up, how the Syrian civil war is taking a toll on Syrian kids. Syria is one of the most dangerous places in the world for children. That is according to a new UNICEF report. It finds more than 10,000 children have been killed during Syria's civil war. On top of that, 5.5 million children are suffering the effects of major trauma. Since the civil war began, more than 3 million kids have been displaced. Around 1.2 million are living as refugees in neighboring countries. The turmoil in the region is also hurting kids' education. More than half of school-aged children aren't able to go to school because of the violence. Some 350,000 Jewish people live in Ukraine, and with a surge in anti-Semitic attacks and the threat of war there, many are considering immigrating to Israel. It is a journey known as Making Aliyah. Edward Dolinsky is the director general for the Ukrainian Jewish community. He tells CBN News the Jews in the country are very concerned about events unfolding in Ukraine.
Many Jews were considering to make an Aliyah in this situation, especially in times when the violence erupted in the streets of Kyiv. And now also because of Russian invasion and all these threats and the danger of war, of course many Jews are considering Aliyah. They're also a very important factor for making Aliyah is this: every Jewish family in Ukraine have relatives in Israel, living in Israel. So we are so much connected that the immigrating to Aliyah is a final and last option, but it's still on the table.
Dolinsky says the Ukrainian Jewish community wants Israel to help them tighten security around synagogues and Jewish schools. And up next, despite the claims of climate change activists, a look at how the world could be heading towards global cooling. Welcome back. Senate Democrats staged an all-night talkathon on climate change. For nearly 15 hours, more than two dozen speakers discussed how it's real and caused by humans. But their leaders made clear they don't plan to bring a climate bill to the Senate floor this year. Republicans largely stayed away, and many Democrats who faced tough re-election fights also avoided the debate. Of course, climate change supporters have spent years warning that global warming is threatening life on Earth. There's just one problem. The Earth isn't getting warmer. In fact, the sun is showing signs that we are headed for something very different, global cooling. Dale Hurd has tonight's Focus report from Copenhagen.
The climate is not getting warmer and seems to be getting much colder. The climate is changing, but it's not changing the way the climate change crowd told us it would change. Nature has made a mockery of global warming. So who are the real climate deniers? The ice is not only growing in the South Pole, but in the North Pole. And the coldest Arctic temperatures in decades have descended upon North America. But this inconvenient truth didn't stop Greenpeace from trying to scare children last month with a video of a sweaty, beleaguered Santa Claus threatening to call off Christmas because the North Pole is melting.
Dear children, regrettably, I bring bad tidings. Melting ice here. The North Pole has made our operations intolerable and impossible. And there may be no alternative but to cancel Christmas.
Cheer up, Santa. Arctic ice is growing, but that may not be the good news that it seems to be, because there are signs the Earth could be entering a very unpleasant cooling period. Sunspot activity remains very low.
The sun has been very unusual for 15 years now.
Senior scientist Jens Petersen at Denmark's Technical University says the sun recently reached solar maximum, and there should be a lot of sunspot activity. But there isn't.
There would normally have been maybe twice or three times as many sunspots as we have seen this year. We have to go back more than 100 years to find a similar solar maximum, which has been so weak as the one we are in right now.
The last time the sun was this quiet, from the 1600s to the 1800s, North America and Europe suffered through a weather event known as Little Ice Age, when the Thames River in London regularly froze solid, and colonial America saw terrible winters. Crops failed, and people starved. Petersen says climate scientists know the Earth stopped warming 15 years ago. But the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, of which Petersen is a member, suppressed a recent finding by its own scientists that the UN's climate model has been proven wrong.
And then they change also part of what the scientists have written. And in particular, one of the issues has been why global warming has stopped during the last 15 years. And the scientists were very frank about that this is a problem, that climate models do not match with the climate we observe.
Politicians removed that important piece of good news from the final draft. It's as if the imminent danger from climate change can't be wrong, because it's now too important. It's become a political movement, a cash cow for climate scientists and environmental groups, and some say a way for world leaders to control economics and people.
This is absolutely a political agenda.
Dan Gaynor of the Media Research Center.
When you look at what the government will be able to do with climate change, it gives them entree into literally every aspect of our lives.
Yeah, I call it climatism.
Steve Gorham is the author of The Mad, Mad, Mad World of Climatism.
It has become a path for global change across the world, for adopting green economies and electric cars and putting wind turbines everywhere and changing light bulbs.
And it doesn't matter how badly the climate change prophets of doom get it wrong. Al Gore said all the ice in the Arctic would be melted by now. It's growing. Others predicted a shrinking food supply and flooded coastlines. Hurricane Sandy and Typhoon Haiyan are said to be because of climate change. But that ignores the fact that the worst tropical cyclones in modern times occurred in the 1960s. The climate change agenda is going forward anyway. The world is already spending at least $250 billion a year on it. Environmentalists want more. Activists are demanding what they call climate justice from developed nations.
What they really want to do is dump trillions into it. They want to get somewhere between 1% and 3% of global GDP. I mean, the amount's staggering amount of money.
Climate change skeptics have been censored and compared to Holocaust deniers and even child molesters. But forgotten in the effort to save the world from warming is the effect on the world's poor. Gorham says more than 1 billion people do not have access to electricity, and almost as many struggle with unreliable power. Cheap electricity from coal would be a savior for the world's poor, but the world's wealthy nations don't want them to have it. All in the name of saving the planet from a crisis that mounting evidence suggests is non-existent. Dale Hurd, CBN News, Copenhagen.
Up next, an Oregon family calls 911 to be rescued from the fury of their cat. All right, cat lovers, you might want to step out of the room for this next story. Now, pets are normally considered friendly, but an Oregon family had to run, hide, and call the cops on their own cat.
911. Yeah, hi. I have a kind of a particular emergency here. My cat attacked our 7-month-old child, and I kicked the button, the cat in the rear, and it has went off over the edge, and we aren't safe around the cat. It's a very large Himalayan, and we're trapped in our bedroom. He won't let us out of our door.
Yikes. It all started when the 22-pound cat scratched the family's 8-month-old baby in the face. The baby's father kicked the cat away, as he said, sending the cat into a rage. Police caught the cat using a pole with a noose on the end and put it in its cage. Police say, according to the baby's father, the cat did have a history of violence. Yikes, watch out. That's all for this edition of NewsWatch. Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at CBN.